what interested me to bring out this new the collected volume. So I'll be most interested, I'll be most happy to take some of your questions.
Therefore, firstly, ask any question if any comments, observations or any doubt is there, please.
Someone has a question. I just saw a message. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Ramachandran, for this wonderful talk and reminding us of the wonderful heritage of journalism in Punjab, especially the contribution of the Tribune in, you know, not only developing some values, but standing by them. Which is indeed remarkable. You know, my name is Vikas Rathi. I teach history here. So my question is a bit related and a bit unrelated to what you spoke about. I wanted to ask if where do you see the ethics of journalism headed in the present scenario? You know, especially.
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah. So, do you feel that print journalism and television journalism have gone on totally separate roads as far as journalistic ethics are concerned? And if so, what do you see to be the future of print in India? I mean, I lived in the US for some time, and the print newspapers are increasingly, especially the local ones, are certainly going out of print, so to speak. Although things like New York Times or LA Times are certainly doing well. So just wondering, so two questions, journalistic ethics, the difference between television and print, and the future of print. Thank you.
I'm extremely happy, Mr. Rathi, that you yourself have understood that there is a divergence. So as long as you understand, you people are more than discerning readers, you are a historian. And so as long as discerning readers and discerning viewers understand the difference between print and television, our problem is largely solved. Because you know and you see that there is a problem in one place and you don't see that problem elsewhere. You think that, there is a problem as far as journalistic ethics are concerned in one medium, and you don't see that problem in another medium. So once you understand that there is a divergence, once you understand that, in these two media, there is a conflict, where there is a conflict as far as values are concerned, then that itself shows that, we need not now, tom-tom what we are and what we are not. You have already understood that. So that explains it. Now, only thing that you need to do is to switch off the television. So once you switch off the television, the problem is largely solved. But then, there are people who want to see it, and that is why such stuff is being put out. Now, as far as the death of print medium is,
at least in the first world, I don't see such trends in India yet. At least
India, the regional. I don't like to use the term vernacular, because that's a colonial condescending term. So as far as regional language media are concerned, we are still growing. India is one of those rare places where print medium is still growing as far as regional language press is concerned, regional language newspapers are concerned. So there is a lot more scope for having better journalism, having quality journalism in regional language newspapers. Unfortunately, in many places, it is lacking because of various reasons. Now, in the first world, why do you have to, first world, they are not using paper. they're not using paper for very many things. So why do you expect them to use paper for news? So when you are not using paper, when your life itself has become paperless, so then you may not be consuming news on a piece of paper. But that doesn't mean that you are not consuming the written word. You are not consuming news as the written word. You are consuming news on a tablet, on your mobile phone. See, even now, you people don't even realize how much news you are consuming on your mobile phone or on your tablet. Much, much more probably than what you were consuming when you were reading only one newspaper. Because right now you read one or two newspapers, whatever your preferences are at home. And then after that, all through the day, you are scrolling down some news item or the other, some story, some article, some interesting snippet, whether it is on WhatsApp, whether it is through WhatsApp, whether it is through Facebook, whether it is through Twitter. End of the day, you are consuming news. So news is not dying. The medium in which it is being published, the way in which it is being consumed, that is getting changed. So you may be consuming news through Facebook now, through Twitter now, through WhatsApp now, or through some other medium as a newsletter probably. Earlier, you were consuming news only through newspapers. So it is the medium through, it's the same, probably it's the same article, same Tribune article, which would be coming through to you through your Facebook wall.
Thank you. So, and a small frivolous question, will Tribune also have a TV channel?
First of all, we have skipped that generation already. Now everything is online. So we have our videos online. If you you can subscribe to our videos online on YouTube, or our videos are available on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. Our videos are available on Facebook, on Twitter, and also on our website.
Yes, please.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Please go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, thanks a lot for giving new insights on this massacre. I am Vipin Pal Singh with the Department of English. You have given a new insight in the context of V.N. Datta's research, that how he pointed out it was Hansraj who lured certain people. But by and large, what I do feel that certainly there was some kind of complicity or some kind of role of the elite category within Punjab. My question is that, do you feel that there was some kind of complicity or some kind of passiveness or some kind of lack of rigor on the part of local elite, especially the Nawabs or those people who were given certain titles like Sir or Maharajas of Punjab? What was their role? Was there any kind of resistance on their part? Or did the Tribune ever give any space to that kind of resistance on the part of elite of Punjab?
See, after 1857, all those Rajas who survived, whatever they would want to call themselves, whether Rajas, Maharajas, whatever, all those who survived were stooges of the British. Because the British had ensured from the Mughal Emperor, the last Emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar onwards, to the smallest Raja, smallest chieftain, either transported for life and made to die in utter poverty and destitution in places like Burma in the case of Bahadur Shah Zafar, or in various places for others, smaller chieftains. Most of them were killed. Most of them were mercilessly killed. People were blown off on cannon mouths. It was so. After that, whoever remained were only stooges. So what do you expect from the stooges? Do you expect any students to stand up? So there was nobody to stand up. And interestingly, in fact, your question is very interesting, because in the run up to the massacre, in the days preceding the massacre, these Rajas and Rai Sahabs, they had put out appeals asking people not to agitate, because when Gandhi was arrested, Gandhi on his way to Punjab was arrested and sent back to Bombay Presidency, Punjab erupted. And there was violence. There were violent protests all across. So all these Rajas and Rai Sahabs, all that they did was to appeal to tell people not to protest. So, but that is hardly surprising, because there were only stooges left.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Any other question, please?
So you have one question in the chat box.
Yeah, please.
By a student.
Yeah, can you please read it out to me? Because
yeah, somebody who's Anusha Hegde, she's asking, we have annual literary festivals and other programs that discuss issues pertaining to society, history and culture in a critical manner for a few days every year, which are conducted by prominent media houses in our country. Can we expect the same on a more regular basis from print media? Because it keeps our minds active. That's what she's saying. So any comment or addressing of this?
To the students, my first comment, or rather request, would be, first of all, they should read the newspaper every day. The present generation, wherever I go, whichever campus I go, to my utter dismay, I find that very, very few students to read newspapers on a daily basis. So unless you engage with the newspaper, whatever be it, with the newspaper of your choice, you know, it is 3 days a year or 4 days a year are not going to make a difference. What is going to make a difference is when you engage with a newspaper every day on a daily basis.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for your thought-provoking, comprehensive and enlightening lecture. And you have highlighted the role of media house. We have journalists, editors play a very important role, and how they shape the soul of the intellectual people, ultimately announcing the mind of God, etc., etc. So with these words, I would request our Jishwar sir, KPS Mundra ji, please propose vote of thanks.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you, Dr. Mahal. Respected Shri Rajesh Ramachandraji, Editor in Chief, The Tribune, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Central University of Punjab, Professor R.P. Tiwari ji, Professor V.K. Garg, Dean Student Welfare, faculty, staff, student, and all the participants. It's my privilege to express the vote of thanks to Shri Ramachandraji, Editor-in-Chief, The Tribune, for enlightening us on Jallianwala Bagh, Martyrdom to Freedom, under the special lecture series of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahamatsav, organized by the Central University of Punjab on the occasion of 75-year celebration of India's independence. As an Editor-in-Chief, you are holding a great responsibility of maintaining the trust of masses in the democratic setup by giving them a platform to speak. As far as my knowledge is concerned, sir, the meaning of the Tribune is an ancient Rome official to provide protection to ordinary people. And by doing free and fearless journalism, the Tribune is doing a commendable job. During the freedom struggle of India, the Tribune remained a vehicle of free expression of nation's voice and prepared Indian masses for participation in the freedom struggle against colonial masters without any fear. the founder of the Tribune, Sardar Dayal Singh Pajithia, wanted to play a role in the freedom struggle, which was still in its nascent years. He was very particularly concerned about the British newspapers, the civil and military gazettes, which was brainwashing the people of that time with official propaganda. By keeping that in view, he started the Tribune from Lahore. I acknowledge the role of Tribune's founders and its all former editors in getting rid of the British rule through fearless writing and revolutionary methods, and the way Tribune supported the freedom fighters. As in 1919, the fearless Tribune described Rowlatt Act as a blunder of collegiate magnitude. From Kalidath Ray, Prem Bhatia, Raj Nanga to Harish Khare, all fearless editors, and now you, I wish that legacy of the Tribune to serve the country, its people, and nation would continue with leap and bound, sir. Mr. Ramachandraji, today I want to share my profound memories with the Tribune to you about its legacy. I am also drawn to Chandigarh. My late father always used to start his day by reading with the Tribune and ended up his day with the Tribune. Before partition, my father was working at Punjab University, Lahore, and as told by him, he used to read the newspaper when the Tribune was published from the Lahore. And we used to ask him, what is special in this paper and that you read it every day? He replied, once you start reading it, you would know what is special in it and would become an integral part of your life. And that's what correct. And the love, affection, and legacy for the Tribune in our family is continued for our fourth generation. Sir, I express my great indebtedness and sincere thanks to Mr. Rajesh Ramachandraji, Editor-in-Chief, for sparing his valuable time and speaking on the topic. I guess we could not have better speaker than him for speaking on Jallianwala Bagh, martyrdom to freedom. Thank you very much, sir. I would like to express my profound gratitude to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor R.P. Tiwari ji, for his continuous guidance, direction, and presidential address, and inviting such a person of excellence and giving all us opportunity to hear his talk. Thank you, sir. I also congratulate Dr. Baba Singh for organizing this wonderful webinar. I also thank to all the faculty members, non-teaching staff members, officers, and students participating in this webinar. Thank you very much. Jai Hind, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. So I would request all please rise up for national anthem.
भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा यमुना गंगा उच्चल जल विकरणा शुभ नामे जागे तब शुभ आशीष मांगे जय जन मंगल गायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे